فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
During Ayin prayers, the sunnah is to recite the whole of Surah Qaf in the first rak'ah and the whole of Surah Al-Qamar in the second, or recite Surah Al-A'la and Al-Ghashiyah.
So here again, Salatul Eid, we have two sunnahs. You can either read Surah Al-Qaf, all of it, and then Surah Iqtarabat Sa'ati wa Shaqqa Al-Qamar. You see? And then you can also read, if you want, Surah Al-A'la, Subhi Isma Rabbika Al-A'la, and Surah Al-Ghashiyah, Hala Ta'ala Nisani Hin. هل هل الإنسان حين من الدار لم يكن شيئا مذكورا نعم لا لا هل تعالى الإنسان هل تاك حديث الغاشية sorry هل تاك حديث الغاشية so sometimes change it over sometimes go this way and sometimes go that way هيا
again both are authentically reported practices and should therefore be practiced without taking one at the expense of leaving out the other
it's true نعم you shouldn't you should always try to make sure that you follow the sunnah in all of these matters and revive that فصل فيما يقرأ في سنتي الفجر والمغرب وفيما يقرأ في الاستخارة والوتر ويقرأ في ركعتي سنة الصبح بعد الفاتحة في الأولى قل يا أيها الكافرون وفي الثانية قل هو الله أحد وإن شاء قرأ في الأولى قل آمنوا قولوا آمنا بالله وما أنزل إلينا الآية وفي الثانية قل يا أهل الكتاب تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بيننا وبينكم ألا نعبد إلا الله الآية فكلاهما صحيح من فعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ويقرأ في السنة المغرب قل يا أيها الكافرون وقل هو الله أحد ويقرأ بهما أيضا في ركعتي الطواف وركعتي الاستخارة ويقرأ من أوتر بثلاث ركعات في الركعة الأولى سبح اسم ربك الأعلى وفي الثانية قل يا أيها الكافرون وفي الثالثة قل هو الله أحد والمعوذتين نعم
One should also recite Surah Al-Kafirun in the first rak'ah of the supererogatory prayer before the dawn prayer, and recite Al-Ikhlas in the second. One may also recite the verses starting with, Say, we believe in Allah and that which was revealed to us and that which was revealed to you. These are found in Al-Baqarah, Ayah 132. Also in the first rak'ah and recite, Say, O people of the scripture, come to a word which is equal between us and you in Surah Al-Ali Imran, Ayah 64. In the second rak'ah, and there are also authentically reported practices. During the supererogatory prayer, following the sunset prayer, it is recommended that one recite Surah Al-Kafirun in the first rak'ah and Al-Ikhlas in the second. Both of these chapters should also be recited in the two rak'ahs after circumambulating the Kaaba and in the
istikhara
phase.
So what's the sunnah to read for istikhara? Huh? An imam, look at the bottom, the Hamish. Look at the Hamish where he says. Look what he says. He says, قال العلامة ابن علان رحمه الله في الفتوحات الربانية قال الحافظ الزين العراقي لم أجد في شيء من طرق الحديث تعين ما يقرأ في ركعتي الاستخارة لكن ما ذكره النووي مناسب لأنهما سورتا الإخلاص فناسب الاتيان بهما في صلاة المراد منها الإخلاص الرغبة والصدق التفويض وإظهار العجز وسب وسبق إليه الغزالي في إحياء علوم الدين ولو قرأ ما وقع فيه ذكر الخيرة كآية القصص وآية الأحزاب لكن حسنا This evidence for Salatul Istikhara, what you should be reading, is not found in any of the sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. That you should be reading قُلْ يَا الْكَافِرُونَ قُلْ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ But what is good about what Nawawi is saying here is that Istikhara is that you're solely asking Allah for something, right? So it's good to read Surah Ikhlas. Since it's sincerely you're asking Allah for something. Istikhara is what you pray when you have a choice to make in life. Whether you want to go forward for something and you want to do something. If you got a job, you can pray istikhara for it. If you want to get married, and it's you got a proposal, or a sister's got a marriage proposal, or a brother wants to go forward for a sister, but he's got another sister in mind, he doesn't know which one to go forward with, he does the istikhara. But you don't do istikhara if you have, you don't do istikhara for the idea of marriage. Do you do istikhara for the idea of marriage? No, that's a sunnah. It's something you should do generally. But it's like you've got two people in front of you, okay, and it's hard to choose between the two. And you're in a state of confusion. Then you can ask Allah, Ya Allah, which one shall I take? Is this one good for me? Oh Allah, whichever of those is good for me, bring them forward. Yeah? You see, whichever of those is good, bring them forward. And if this person isn't, Ya Allah, don't bring them forward to me. Sah? And then after that, you rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So later when you do your istikhara and you finish praying your istikhara, whatever is written for you will come forward. Now. Now. Yeah. So I like a blue car and a... Yeah, so you got two cars to choose from. You have to go forward with one of the options. And say, Ya Allah, if it's written for me, bring it forward. So when there's two choices on the table, you go forward for one of the choices. Once you go forward for that choice, if it's not for you and Allah doesn't want it for you, what's going to happen? Doors are going to be closed on you. It just won't happen. The blue car will be taken. The job that you wanted will call you and say, hi there sir, we don't have a position for you no longer. You're not shortlisted anymore, blah, 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 blah. Okay, thank you. That wasn't written for you. The sister will call you and say, I'm sorry brother, I have to travel that time, my family. They're always making excuses up. They're just trying to say to you, you're not the one for me. They'll always say to you, my family, I have to speak to my uncle, he's not in the country, right, he's going to come back. If any of you heard those excuses, I'm telling you, it's a nice way of saying, ack, I don't like your guts. That's what it is. Ala kulli hal, what you know is lacking, this is your istikhara taking place, and it wasn't written for you. This person was not, it wasn't written for you. Allah may have not given you good children from this relationship, maybe. So don't weep over that. The same with the sister. If the brother makes excuses and he doesn't go forward with it and he pulls back and he does this and taqdeem and ta'khir, and he just doesn't, he just never takes it serious, then what you need to remember is, it's what? He could be the serial killer that kills you or something. So always know, khair is in what Allah has written, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You might even sometimes get into a relationship and think to yourself, whoa, my istikhara went wrong. That doesn't mean that it went wrong. It can mean that you possibly don't assume that this relationship is right. Like, wow, we're fighting all day, we're always consistent conflicts, back and forth, every day shouting, and who can shout the loudest? I shout loud, she just goes up, I go up, she goes up, and then the roofs come down. Maybe you see this to be but that's your perception. Maybe Allah, there's a lot of khair that's going to come from this. A lot of khair that you probably can't see right now. Are you with me, brothers? So the reality of how do you evaluate what's right and what's wrong and what's good and what's bad is to leave it all to Allah. How many things have you seen from the apparent, you're like, wow, this is the real deal. This is it, this is the one. But when you got in, you're like, no, what just happened? Does that make sense? So from the zahir, things can look good, but look bad from the inner. That's why you always rely on Allah, and you always know that when you pray your istikhara, whatever, if you take that blue car, if you go for that job, whatever you've done after the istikhara, you know inshaAllah ta'ala there's khair in it. There is khair in it, and may Allah always bring us the khair that are in every situation of our lives.
If one wishes to pray witr in the three rak'ahs, it is recommended that he recite Surah Al-A'la in the first rak'ah, Al-Kafirun in the second, and then Al-Ikhlas, Al-Nas, and Al-Falaq in the third rak'ah.
فصل فيما يستحب قراءته يوم الجمعة ويستحب أن يقرأ سورة الكهف يوم الجمعة لحديث أبي سعيد الخدري وغيره فيه قال الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى في الأم ويستحب أن يقرأها أيضا ليلة الجمعة ودليل هذا ما رواه أبو محمد الدارمي بإسناده عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال من قرأ سورة الكهف ليلة الجمعة أضاء له من النور فيما بينه وبين البيت العتيق. وذكر الدارمي حديثا في استحباب قراءة سورة هود يوم الجمعة وعن مكحول التابعي الجليل استحباب قراءة آل عمران يوم الجمعة. فصل في استحباب قراءة آية الكرسي والمعوذتين. ويستحب الإكثار من تلاوة آية الكرسي في جميع المواطن وأن يقرأ كل ليلة إذا أوى إلى فراشه ويقرأ المعوذتين عقب كل صلاة. فقد صح عن عقبة بن عامر رضي الله عنه قال أمرني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن أقرأ المعوذتين دبر كل صلاة. رواه أبو داود والترمذي والنسائي. وقال الترمذي حديث حسن صحيح. فصل فيما يقرأ عند النوم. يستحب أن يقرأ عند النوم آية الكرسي وقل هو الله أحد والمعوذتين وآخر سورة البقرة فهذا مما يهتم له ويتأكد الاعتناء به فقد ثبتت فيه أحاديث صحيحة. ففي الصحيحين عن أبي مسعود البدري رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الآيتان من آخر سورة البقرة من قرأهما في ليلة كفتها. قال جماعة من العلماء كفتاه من قيام الليل وقال آخرون كفتاه المكروه في ليلته. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان كل ليلة يقرأ قل هو الله أحد والمعوذتين. وقد قدمناه في فصل النفث بالقرآن. وروى ابن أبي داود بإسناده عن علي رضي الله عنه قال ما أرى أحدا يعقل دخل في الإسلام ينام حتى يقرأ آية الكرسي. وعن علي رضي الله عنه أيضا قال ما كنت أرى أحدا يعقل ينام قبل أن يقرأ الآيات الثلاث الأواخر من سورة البقرة. إسناده صحيح على شرط البخاري ومسلم. وعن عقبة بن عامر رضي الله عنه قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تمر بك ليلة إلا قرأت فيها قل هو الله أحد والمعوذتين فما أتت علي ليلة إلا وأنا أقرأهن. وعن إبراهيم النخعي قال كانوا يستحبون أن يقرأوا هؤلاء السور في كل ليلة ثلاث مرات قل هو الله أحد والمعوذتين. إسناده صحيح على شرط مسلم. وعن إبراهيم أيضا كانوا يعلمون إذا أووا إلى فرشهم أن يقرأوا المعوذتين. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا ينام حتى يقرأ الزمر وبني إسرائيل. رواه الترمذي وقال حسن. فصل فيما يقرأ بعد الاستيقاظ. ويستحب أن يقرأ إذا استيقظ من النوم كل ليلة آخر آل عمران من قوله تعالى إن في خلق السماوات والأرض إلى آخرها. فقد ثبت في الصحيحين أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يقرأ خواتيم آل عمران إذا استيقظ. فصل فيما يقرأ عند المريض. يستحب أن يقرأ عند المريض بالفاتحة لقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم في الحديث الصحيح فيها وما أدراك أنها رقية. ويستحب أن يقرأ عنده قل هو الله أحد وقل أعوذ برب الفلق وقل أعوذ برب الناس مع النفث في اليدين. فقد ثبت في ذلك في الصحيحين من فعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وقد تقدم بيانه في فصل النفث في آخر الباب الذي قبل هذا. وعن طلحة بن مصرف قال كان يقال إن المريض إذا قرئ عنده القرآن وجد لذلك خيفة فدخلت على خيثمة وهو مريض فقلت إني أراك اليوم صالحا فقال إنه قرئ عندي القرآن. وروى الخطيب أبو بكر البغدادي رحمه الله بإسناده أن الرمادي رضي الله عنه كان إذا اشتكى شيئا قال هاتوا أصحاب الحديث فإذا حضروا اقرأوا علي الحديث فهذا في الحديث فالقرآن الكريم أولى. فصل فيما يقرأ عند الميت. قال العلماء من أصحابنا وغير مستحب أن يقرأ عنده ياسين لحديث معقل بن يسار رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال اقرأوا ياسين على موتاكم رواه أبو داود والنسائي في عمل اليوم والليل وابن ماجة بإسناد ضعيف وروى مجالد عن الشعبي قال كانت الأنصار إذا حضروا قرأوا عند الميت سورة البقرة ومجالد ضعيف.
Section. It is also recommended that one recites Surah Al-Kahf on the Friday. As Abu Sa'id Al-Khudri, may Allah have mercy on him, and others narrated a hadith regarding the virtue of doing so. In his book, Imam Shafi'i, may Allah have mercy on him, stated that it is also recommended that one recites this chapter on Friday nights. Proof of this view lies in what Muhammad Al-Darimi narrated with his chain of narration from Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, may Allah be peace with him, who said, whoever recites Surah Al-Kahf on Friday night will have light radiate between himself and the ancient house regarding the holy masjid in Mecca. Ad-Darimi mentioned another hadith stating that reciting Surah Al-Hud on Fridays is also recommended, and Makhul, the noble Tabi'i, narrated that reciting Ali Imran on Fridays is also recommended. Section. It is recommended that Ayat al-Kursi be recited at all times and every night upon going to bed. It is also recommended that one recite Al-Falaq and An-Nas after each prayer, as there is an authentic report by Uqba ibn Amir, may Allah be pleased with him, stating that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded me to read the Mu'addatain, meaning Al-Falaq and An-Nas, after each prayer. Abu Dawood, At-Timridi and An-Nasa'i narrated this hadith, and At-Timridi classified it as Hassan Sahih.
Does it say Timridi or Tirmidhi?
Tirmidhi.
At-Tirmidi
classified it as Hassan Sahih. Section. Upon going to bed, it is recommended that one recite Ayat al-Kursi Surah.
So when you go to sleep, what do you read? Ayat al-Kursi. Who reads it? One, ayah, Allahumma barik, two, three, four, five. MashaAllah.
One.
Who else? You read it. Sisters read? Or you guys just jump in bed? So.
Ayat al-Kursi, Surah al-Ikhlas and Muwaddatain. And the last portion of Surah al-Baqarah.
Who reads all of that? All of it, Allahumma barik. Yeah? Not what? You don't read the last part of Baqarah. You don't read Mu'awwidhatayn. Do you Ayat al-Kursi? But you don't read Ayat al-Kursi? Aman al-Rasul bima unzileh. That's that. From that part onwards. Yeah? Something like that. You sometimes do? Really? I carry on reading, inshallah. Now, from now on, try to do that. And look how your day, how much sleep that you get. Look at it, I promise you guys, you'll see that you can sleep little and study and work a lot. Like I can spend four or five hours a night waking up in the middle of the night, going researching, reading. That's the night I read all of this. The night I go in, subhanAllah. Shaitan goes in with me as well. Not in bed. No, I didn't mean that, wallahi. I mean that he would keep me in bed for as long. I hope that's clear with all of you guys, okay?
There are many authentic reports that show the importance of this practice and the need to be consistent in practicing it. For instance, it is mentioned in both Al-Bukhari and Muslim on the authority of Abu Mas'ud al-Badri, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever recites the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah at night will be sufficed by them.
Allah, wallahi, that's so true. Anybody who recites from Aman al-Rasul, which is the ending of those last two ayahs from Surah Al-Baqarah, ya ikhwad, your angels are looking after you. You're protected. All night, your mouth is just open. No rat is going to go in there. No bugs are going to go in there. You see? If you live in Southall and stuff like that, you're in trouble. There's all rats, big rats living. These Sikhs, they got a lot of rats in their local neighborhood. Yeah. Isn't that the case? Why are you laughing, Pogulu? Is this the area? Okay. I don't live there anymore, alhamdulillah, we moved from there. We now live in North Holt, alhamdulillah. But there's big rats, some of them even when you, like, not in the houses, alhamdulillah, but outside. That they're so big that they can't run away from you. Like, it's not even a rat, is a rat the bigger one or the mice? Rat is big, right? Yeah, big rats. The what's it called? The whiskers are so big and thick. That's what you see in what do you call it, Southall. The point is, like, in Allah will protect you at night. He will send angels that will come and they will protect you. What will they protect you from? All evil. Ya ikhwa, it's not just bugs and things that... Look at people sleeping at night, how their mouth is just open. Look how vulnerable they are. Wallahi, weak. Have you seen a person sleeping? Yeah? If you haven't, just ask your wife to record you, or your sister, or your brother, somebody record me at night how I sleep. And at morning, watch how you look. You'll be shocked the way you are. That's how weak you are. All that night, you want somebody protecting you, looking after you. Allah is going to send you. Now.
Will be sufficed by them. Some scholars have stated that will be sufficed by them means suffice him so that he will be as though he spent the night standing in prayer. While others have said that it means they will protect him against the evil of the night.
So some scholars have said it means Allah will suffice him, meaning he's actually sleeping and ajr is being written for him, like he's praying Qiyamul Layl. That's what it means. If you read Surah Al-Baqarah, the last two ayahs, it's like it's at night he's praying. Just by reading those two verses. Some scholars, they say, no, what it means is that the night time, are you with me, brothers? The harmful things at night, are you there? Walidarikas, Ibn Abi Dunya, in his Mawsu'ah, he mentions, the Salam of the Salaf, their house was protected at night from thieves trying to come in because they read Surah Al-Baqarah. That the thief somehow wasn't able to get into the house. Whenever he felt like going towards it, he felt pain and, huh? You with me, brothers? There are a lot of stories like that, you know. A woman, one time, it was a story that was mentioned that she was there was a local rapist in the neighborhood. On the, you guys heard the story? Yeah. What was the version that you had? What was the narration you had?
She will pass. Sah. Just a few hours before, another woman will pass and raped her.
Sah.
When she will pass,
he didn't touch her at all.
Then the police caught him or something, they asked him why they can rape her.
Yeah.
Because she had two big hench guys.
Hench guys were walking with her. That's what she said. That's my narration as well. Karen, hey? Oh, yours stops there. Yeah, same. Mine stops there as well. But that's the truth, you see? He said, I saw two men walking with her, and I wouldn't find that gharib. I wouldn't find that gharib. Because Allah says in the Quran, لَهُمْ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ مِّن بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. The Quran, ikhwani, Allah, yes, they're protected. So sisters who go out of their houses nowadays, knowing that these acid attacks are happening, destruct, sisters, you need to leave. Brothers are getting attacked. Brothers with lihya who are practicing their, wearing their thobes, Ya akhi, read your dua, your adhkar. Are you there? One time I remember I went to a family, wallahi, some people are very clean hearted and sharp minded. So I was in my family's cousin's house and I was like, this attacks that are happening on the streets now, sisters are being, acid are being thrown at them, and same with the men. I think what I was saying, you know, message should start doing is that they should start some karate, jiu-jitsu lessons for the brothers and sisters, because this ain't right anymore. Brothers need to know how to save them, help themselves. Especially when I watched that East London girl that got punched in the face with that man. It got me angry, so I was like, sisters. And one of my cousins is very young, he goes, no, why don't they just do the adhkar? And they read their daily Quran. I was like, wow, I take that back. And I pretended like I said it. Yeah, I said, why don't we just make them all learn their, yeah? Why don't we then make sure they do the adhkar and Read the Quran. And that's the true reality that we have. Are you with me, brothers? Is that this is what we don't generally remember, which is the Quran and how it can protect us. You find lit. How many people know that the Mu'awwidhatayn? How many people know Ayatul Kursi? How many people who know the ending of Surah Al-Baqarah? But how many really read it? No.
We've already mentioned that Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, reported that the Prophet, may the blessings of Allah be upon him, used to recite Al-Ikhlas and the Mu'awwidhatayn every night. Ibn Abu Dawud narrated with his chain of narration that Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, said, I never thought that a reasonable person who embraced Islam could go to bed without reciting Ayat al-Kursi.
Wallahi, look at that. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, I never thought in my entire life that a person who's got aqal, who entered into Islam, or who's a Muslim, yadabu, he would go to sleep and not read Ayatul Kursi. I never thought that would happen. Ali was shocked that somebody would actually do that. Naam.
He is also reported to have said, I never thought that a reasonable person who embraced Islam could go to bed without reciting the last three verses of Al-Baqarah. This hadith is authentic according to the conditions set by Al-Bukhari and Muslim.
Ali ibn Abi Talib actually went a step further. And what did he say? I didn't even think that a person would actually miss the last three verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. Yeah, he added the last third. That's for him, that was the opinion he held.